Hi, my name is Tommy Kelly. So guys, welcome back to another video. Today what I want to talk about is actually fitness trackers and how they can actually reactivate and ignite eating disorder behaviours and obviously set you back into a relapse. So like I say, I've written a lot of things down here. So like I say, the rise of activity trackers are obviously undeniable. You've got the things like the Jawbone, the Fitbit, your MyFitnessPal, trendy wearable wristbands, tracking obviously your calories, movement, heartbeat. They're no longer the next big thing, they're just the big thing basically. The activity tracker market is huge worldwide, like I say, and it's evolving. Apple's new smartwatch is going to obviously have a new activity tracker in it, as we all know. But as I say, activity trackers become more normal, they're much more documentable downside to them. They obviously fuel potential for eating disorder behaviours. But obviously as well, can these devices be hacked to obviously fix it? Like I say, the propensity of activity trackers and calorie counters to trigger eating disorders and cause relapses in previous sufferers is a pretty well documented phenomenon by now. Like I say, personal stories have abounded from recovering anorexics and bulimics about how the wristband or activity tracker pushed them back over the edge. I've actually spoken to a few people and they said, one actually told me this actual statement. She said, within a week of use, I became addicted. I had to wear it all the time and track every minute of activity correctly, every bite of food, every hour of sleep, everything. But like I say, given the fact that it's pretty much a fact though that the app and technology creators have commented on it, only Fitbit has obviously raised this kind of concern about them. But what the role can these products play themselves in protecting vulnerable people with them themselves? So I've written down a few four actual points that I would like to touch upon, so I'll read these out just following this. Number one problem, trackers tend to reduce health to numbers. So like I say, the model of most food and activity trackers is obviously fairly simple, as you all know. They monitor the amount of calories you intake, the amount of you've burning through your daily activity, and they give you a numerical basis for assessing your health as well. The temptation of this for people with eating disorders is both, like I say, understandable and obviously frightening, as we all know. Eating disorders are often at the psychological root of desire for control, and any assistance in controlling your body down to the minutest numerical element must look like a godsend to most eating disorder sufferers, as we all know. Basically, they actually call this techorexia. That's the name they're actually adopting to this type of behaviour. But like I say, calorie counting is not a sufficient way of understanding how your body processes food. Different foods tell the body to obviously do different aspects and different relations, from building muscle to storing fat. And the mathematics of estimating calories in a food can be radically inaccurate, as we all know, because you can go out to a restaurant and the amount of calories in a food can be altered easily by the amount of sauce they put in, the amount of vegetables they put in. So this just shows you that there's no real actual way of saying, it's just a kind of guideline. So like I say, how could the trackers actually help? Like I say, health is a more diverse than just maintaining a certain level of energy in and energy out, and trackers could be very easily diversified to recognise that, including elements like maybe mood tracking, things like mindfulness, obviously observing sleep patterns, stress management, and other less numerical aspects of health might be trickier to obviously the app itself, but they're already existing. Other forms, making these elements just as important, might help to obviously lessen the problem for the eating disorder sufferer. Number two that I would say is, can trackers actually encourage you to push it? So the main problem is trackers, aside from the adding numerical based models, there's no alarm bell, no stopping, and no concept of giving up or having a rest. As disorders obviously like exercise bulimia, where sufferers binge on exercise sessions, that's a recognised problem. You may see why this is a lack of moderation and built-in stop signs might prove to be difficult. There obviously has been a criticism of the inability of the, for products like the Fitbit to build in like rest days and things like that, even amongst those of us who are obviously vulnerabilities for eating disorders. And for a good reason, the body requires rest or risks severe injury, and certain times are less appropriate for exercise than obviously others. So how could the actual trackers actually help in doing this kind of stop this kind of behaviour? Like I say, is the concepts of restraint would actually be fairly easy to build in. We people with eating disorders tend to be ruthfully truthful in their data input. So like I say, they'll kind of say that they've ate such and such when they haven't really. So that's kind of difficult in itself. So the makers of the app could be fairly confident that their warning signs could be based on the correct information. If the person logged too much exercise, too little food, or simply checked the device or app too often, an inbuilt system could obviously suggest a day of rest, raise a warning to a fellow exerciser, or activate a support system so that could warn your, one of your family members, one of your friends around about that basically they don't think you've actually maybe taken in enough and can I have you that support system in base. Number three problem is trackers tend to encourage focus in numbers rather than your body. So like I say, in some ways thinking of your body as a machine with inputs and obviously outputs is actually a very good idea. The problem that can incur is it can make us dissociate from our bodies, as you know, the things we actually live inside rather than just elements to control and run up and down stairs and things. Like I say, activity trackers with their weight and numerical of achievement are easy ways to draw the focus from the body and onto leveling up and achieving high scores on the device. So like I say, this can be helpful for some, but dangerous for people with eating disorders. So people that want to try and lose weight, obviously for health reasons, or maybe they've got a heart problem and things, they can be beneficial for them. But for somebody with an eating disorder, this is going to be really triggering. Like I say, eating disorders are all about turning away from the voice of your own body. Like basically saying, help, I'm hurting, and things like that. If help, I'm hungry. Improving your own self-control by listening to something else instead. The something else, basically, in the case of being obviously the fitness tracker. So you're taking away one eating disorder and you're buying into another. So it's like one voice for the other. So like I say, how could the trackers basically help with this? They could bring about a device and a body closer together, and how you can your device could obviously make yourself listen to your needs rather than it. A series of suggestions that prompt introspection and examination of the body, like how are you feeling after a workout, how are your muscles, are they aching, or things like that. Maybe a day later they'll ask you, how is your mood today? That may serve as and keep us all attuned to our body rather than tuned out. Number four is, I say, some trackers emphasize negativity. So basically, like I say, there was actually a thing that the Daily Dot pointed out in 2014, that there was a nasty trend in activity trackers and apps tend to emphasize some serious punishment thinking. A particularly culprit, they said, was the carrot fit, which is horrible things to you until you basically lose weight. And there's a diet, my diet coach, which is motivational statements like, imagine what it would be like if you had a flat belly, do you want one, control yourself, or Fitbit's notoriously shaming smiley faces, which tell very grumpy if you dare to go below a certain activity level. So like I say, these are not ways to be thinking about exercise and getting a body. These perfect bodies that's in these magazines are unattainable. Many of these people's they're photoshopped, they're on steroids and things like that, and you shouldn't attend to be like that. It's all about body positivity. Love yourself for who you are. Don't focus on numbers. And like I say, you should be doing exercise for the feel-good factor and enjoying it, not to be base yourself on a weight and not doing it because you feel you have to. When you're dragging yourself to the gym every single day because you feel you have to go and as a form of punishment, and going when you're ill and things like that is not healthy. That is an exercise disorder, and you've got to realise that. So like I say, how could the trackers basically help? Like I say, some apps have already started to come out with a target or element of calorie counting products specifically for people who are in recovery for eating disorders. Recovery Record is designed to obviously help recovering sufferers keep track of not only their weight and medical progress, but also their mood, and it's unfailingly positive all the way. Like I say, other apps that I actually use are the Rise Up and Recover app and Eating ED are in an idea too, but they all like every app with food diaries or activity levels, even if meant well, are vulnerable to obviously exploitation. So you've got to basically watch, but these apps are good because they ask you how you're feeling today, how you felt eating that meal, basically how's your mood and things like that. So it's a really good thing to look back and maybe look through your diary and say, oh well, I ate such and such today, or I didn't eat this and that and I felt such and such, or I felt good, I felt bad. It's a way of looking back and maybe seeing where you can go right and where you went wrong and be able to move on from that. So like I say, a general move towards positivity and holistically about health is about self-strengthening rather than obviously punishment. And it's about more than just calories. Could give a lot of people a bit more peace of mind while still encouraging them to get off the couch. So like I say, guys, I hope you've enjoyed this. And like I say, if you're in eating disorder recovery, I thoroughly don't recommend fitness trackers or MyFitnessPal or anything like that. Your eating disorder thrives in numbers, and anything you can do that's basically going to fuel those eating disorder numbers is going to push you further and further and further. We all know that, especially when you're in the grips of an eating disorder, your eating disorder will lie to you and say, oh, once you get to such and such a number of weight, you'll be happy. That's lies, you know that. Once you get to that weight, you feel even worse and worse and worse. And this is something a lot of people that don't suffer eating disorders don't understand, because they think that we base our eating disorder on numbers, and once we get to our weight, we're happy and things like that. That's far from the truth. Your eating disorder will lie to you. Your eating disorder doesn't want to kill you, but it wants to push you towards the very, very end of the gap, right to the cliff edge, if you can imagine that. Because if your eating disorder kills you, it kills itself. But it's going to lead you down that path, and you've got to understand that that voice shouting at you, you can keep it whispering away to you. I always believe that you suffer with an eating disorder for the rest of your life, and it's just about you being in control. A lot of people say that it's like an alcoholic or a drug addict and things like that. Yeah, the addiction side of it is very much like that. But the difference with somebody suffering with alcoholism and drug addiction is they can go to drug addiction classes and Alcoholics Anonymous and rehab and things like that, and they can stay away from those drugs and alcohol. But with us, every single day we are facing a demon that we need to keep ourselves alive, and that's food. So it's a very much different complex illness, and it's one that you're going to have to find techniques that work with you, for you, whether that be cognitive behavioural therapy or anything that your eating disorder team, if you have one, actually finds that it works for you. So like I say, I hope yous have liked this video, guys, today. And if yous would like any other videos focusing upon eating disorder recovery or any kind of aspects that you suffer with that keeps you in behaviours and things like that, please let me know. And also as well, I was thinking of doing these eating disorder recovery videos a type of podcast. So basically, it will just be a picture you'll see on the screen of me and me speaking away. Would this be something yous would really like? If so, comment below, let me know, guys, and I'll speak to you all in the next video. And remember what the little guy at the end of the video says, he knows best. Remember, guys, binge on life, purge negativity and starve guilty feelings. Speak to you all soon, and love you so much.